Another way to think about six-point perspective is to paint on a sphere itself. So these grids can be used in a couple of different ways. They can be thought of as a flat thing, but they can also be thought of as spheres themselves. So this is working its way toward what I've spent 50 years doing, is painting on spheres. And a lot of times when I create the spheres, I usually start with a flat version, try it on a small sphere, and then I move to a bigger one. But this is like where I'm actually inside a transparent ball. I'm aware of north, south, east, west around me, up and down around me, and how does that all fit onto a sphere? This was a sphere I did that actually shows a complete 360 in all directions around you onto the sphere. So it's a complete city that I created. And then what I did was I put canvases, like the yellow that's showing up here is how much of it would be a one-point perspective. A two-point perspective is the red-violet rectangle that's showing up in that. So it's 90 degrees of the sphere, some of the above you, some of below you, in order to create a two-point. And then this was a three-point, which is the triangle that we talked about. And the yellow is a triangle up above you. The four-point perspective is the combination of the three-point yellow on the top and mixing it with the violet on the bottom left. And you put those two together, you get the four-point perspective. And then the half of the sphere gives you a five-point perspective. So that sphere was trying to do a little thesis on one through six-point perspective on the six-point perspective sphere. This one was the first sphere I ever created. And it was a simple cubical room that I was standing inside of, and being aware that I could put a table on the floor, I could do a mirror on the wall, but I realized at that point, it was like a light bulb awareness. See the light bulb hanging there? It was sort of like, an aha moment. This one is a six-point perspective grid, and then I let some cubes emerge out of that grid, and then I also have the inside of a room emerging out of that grid too. So it's mixing the inside, the outside, kind of blurring one into the other. Food for thought is an example of how the 6 points can be used to create a real environment. This is from down in Santa Fe, New Mexico, in the La Fonda Hotel.
So I want to introduce an idea to you in putting the 6 points of perspective onto the sphere and capturing complete worlds around you, the up, down, and all around world. I'm going to show you step by step how I do that. The first thing I need to do is explain how you get 6 equal distant points on the sphere. You usually know the top, or you can make a mark on the top of the ball. And so what I'm doing right now is on that flexible tape, I'm doing different stretchings from the top point around to the bottom and making a mark, just kind of guessing where the bottom is. And as soon as I get about 3 or 4 guessings that are all the same size, I know exactly where the bottom is. As soon as I have the bottom, then I'm trying to find, okay, where's the halfway point between that tape from the top and the bottom? That would be where the center vanishing points are, because there's 4 vanishing points around the perimeter of the sphere. And so you can see what I've done here is I've taken the tape. Now that I know where the top and the bottom is, I folded the paper in half, and then I know exactly where a quarter of the way is, and I came around and measured that around, and then I came back with a more accurate measurement of each of the vanishing points around the center. So there's probably a lot of different ways you could do that, but that's just to give you a hint of how I use the flexible tape. So now I have 6 different vanishing points on the sphere. What I'm doing right now is doing a grid. In this kind of perspective, every vanishing point that I use has an opposite vanishing point. So the lines of the grid run from one side to the opposite side, and they make kind of an explosion of lines coming from one side to the opposite. So there's one point that's going from north to south, you might say, another one from east to west, and another one from up to down below. And then What I'm going to do is draw the inside of a room, which is a cubicle room. And you can see that I'm drawing squares, but the squares have to be part of the grid. So every set of parallel lines would project to opposite sides of the ball. And you can see how I'm constructing this cubicle structure. And once you get one square done, you got to play off the corners with the next one. And I didn't want this to just be centered, like you're standing in the center of a room. I wanted it to be off kilter a little bit. I'm using a wipe-offable ink, and I'm on a very glossy ball, so it actually can be erased. Once I get the structure the way I like it, then I come back with my permanent pen and accent the lines. I'm also showing here how you can break into each one of those sides and make it be a much more complicated room. It's all of a sudden that wall has been broken into, and every line, if you're drawing properly, it should echo what the outside lines are doing. If you take the outside wall line, and every line that you draw inside of it has to echo or repeat going to the same vanishing points as the other. So now I'm doing doors and windows. The secret to when you draw a door or a window is it should look just like the wall that it's on. But that's what's going on here, is I'm breaking into that original wall with windows and doors and rooms that go back in. Even if it's permanent pen, a lot of times I'll come back with acrylic paint if I've made a mistake and re-straighten that out again. Now you can see you're starting to look into this room, and each one of the walls can be extended back in space. It's a point in space, and the difference is you're having to do the inside of the room on the outside of the ball. So when you look at this, just imagine it's concave instead of convex. But you just follow the same system of perspective, find the vanishing points that should be going towards that, and make it adjust to whatever you already have in the room. You can see you can add depth to the doors, and the windows can have thickness on them. And it's very logical, once you start using the vanishing points, how that works. Now I'm putting some of the flooring in and looking out the window and seeing what the landscape is. I like to use a landscape in these because it helps you to know that you're looking out. A lot of times we know the landscape, it circles all the way around us. But in this case, you have to look in the windows and then the next window and the next window to see how the landscape all attaches together. I'm coming back to color in the same planes, the same color. You'll end up with six different planes, so there'll be six different colors. So you can see, even when you go back in space, like that wall is just like the same plane as the wall out in front of it.
I'm done coloring. What I do a lot of times with the color is I color in the planes. How this is yellow and that's the same plane as this one up here. You notice that when you're looking in now that this ceiling is coming up above you and this floor is coming down below you and the walls are coming around you. That's the logic of this. And if you follow that grid and you keep it all organized as you go along, you can come up with all kinds of cathedrals and famous houses, and this works great with landscape. It's just the structural stuff, anything that's cubical, this is where this perspective really comes into it. So I hope you enjoyed this. I hope you'll give it a try. It really works pretty good.